Herb Clark, weather, part of the Channel 10 news team, weeknights at 11.
You hear that?
What? I didn't hear anything.
Exactly. Exactly. Oh. Just you, me, and that dress.
Oh, mm-hmm.
In a totally empty house.
Yes.
Yes, Nadine's opening the diner and Julie's off to a doctor's appointment.
Yes, and I have a little bit of time before my next appointment.
What? You mean to tell me we can finally have a conversation without 100 interruptions?
I know, and it's not like we really want to have a conversation, but we have to talk about something. We have to talk about Julie and the other night at the Fiesta. I mean, Frankie, you and I both know all the stories that she told us, and I know you didn't want me to confront her because of what happened, and we didn't. But something's still going on with her, and after I saw her at the diner with you yesterday, Frankie, I think it's time that we get to the bottom of this.
Oh, yeah, hi. This is Julie Camaletti. I had an 8 o'clock appointment with Dr. Benjamin. I overslept. I'm going to be a little late. Well, I thought I could come in at 9. Yeah, tomorrow's fine. I'll be on time. Okay, thanks.
Jumping on my body.
I am tired of waiting to find out what my future holds. I gave you a proposal last night and you never gave me an answer.
I was sleeping last night.
Your brain never sleeps. That's one thing I know about you, Buzz. It never sleeps. Now, my proposal was that we move far away from here and live happily ever after. What do you say?
Been our first night in marriage on a rooftop.
Well, I'm actually glad that Tangie was at the boathouse and Hal and Michael got to the hotel suite first. This was great. Oh, I think I need an adjustment.
Oh, you're kidding. Yeah. Happy first day in marriage.
Yeah. Where to now?
Where we should have gone in the first place. Home.
I couldn't sleep.
Well, I know you want me to feel sorry for you, but how can I, after you brought everything upon yourself?
Monster I must be to him, huh? And to everyone.
Stop it, Alexandra. I'm on your side, remember? That's why I want you to realize what you're doing so you'll just stop spinning your wheels on everything. Nick came after you last night and he apologized.
No, out of duty. And to smooth things over.
Well, he didn't come over to grovel if that's what you expected.
I'm not asking him or anyone else to grovel. I think I do expect a little bit more than, hey, Mom, sorry. We'll just pretend it never happened. I do want him to understand that he hurt me deeply. Is that asking too much?
Oh, will you knock it off? What suddenly happened to your short-term memory?
That was a long time ago.
It wasn't that long ago. Don't you remember? You pulled every trick in the book to keep Nick and Mindy apart. Why the hell would they want you to be at their wedding? Man, they just should have eloped, but oh no, no. Your son Nick, he wanted to do the right thing and the smart thing. He wanted you to be there, but he didn't want to give you enough time to put another obstacle in their path.
I wasn't going to try to stop them this time.
Are you listening to me? That is not the point here. The point is that Nick and Mindy had every good reason to believe that you might. Come on, Alexandra. Please. Accept some responsibility for what's happened.
Nick.
Mm-hmm.
Your mother practically disowned you last night. How can you want to go back there? I can understand if you want to make up with her, but we can do that another way. Look, we already decided that we were going to come back from our honeymoon and build a house on the land that we bought from Dylan. That was our plan, and that's what I'd like to do.
Well, I guess I had another plan in mind, honey.
Yeah, I guess you did. Your mother's house?
Yeah.
Look, I know she gave it to you as a gift, but you weren't considering us living there permanently, were you?
I thought that we could talk about it.
When?
After the wedding. Look, honey, I know that maybe I should have discussed it with you before the wedding started taking on its own momentum, but I thought that I would have all the time in the world. Who knew that things would fall out the way they did with my mother?
Nobody did. But now that it happened, how can you seriously consider that we should go back there?
Well, actually, that's what I would like to do.
Buzz, I'm not just thinking of myself. I know how much you love your family. It's just very difficult to sit back and watch you constantly proving yourself to them. They are wonderful people. I have grown very fond of them all. Well, some of them. But I feel, truthfully, that it's so important for us to move away, far away, someplace else where we can have our own life. So that we don't have to keep apologizing for everything. You could fly and visit them anytime you wish. They could fly and visit you at any time. But we need space so that we can grow and change. All the time we're having to make excuses for what we want. I don't want anything or anyone to stop us, to get in our way. I want us to be brave and daring and successful and madly in love and to live life to its fullest.
All we have is a grub stake. That is not enough to buy the lifestyle and mansion that you want in Beverly Hills.
We have enough money to have one hell of a good start, and if we play our cards right, we can turn it into millions.
Oh, what a game that was.
What a backhand. You were fantastic.
We both were fantastic. In the clubhouse, we finished that deal. It was a coup.
How credit goes to you, puss. And you started talking about international marketing and power distribution. He was a goner, so what'll it be? Champagne or mineral water?
Oh, mineral water, Buzzy darling, with a twist. The wonderful thing about being a billionaire is that you have so many choices.
True, true, kumquat. Beverly Hills is the ultimate. None of this would have been possible if you hadn't been able to parlay my $140,000 into a bona fide fortune. Brains, guts, vision. You've got them all. To zero.
Oh, but it was you who believed in me and came to this promised land with me. Behind every successful woman, there is the sexiest of men. If it weren't for your encouragement and care, and your earth-shattering kisses, I would still be in Springfield pushing bottles of lotion. But instead, I am the president of the biggest cosmetic company in the world. Oh, dear, I've got to get ready. The photo people are coming for that layout.
Jenna B. Cooper, Woman of the Year for outstanding achievement in business and finance and charitable endeavors. Oh, they want a shot of you in front of the hospital wing we donated at the Betty Ford Clinic for Actors. Oh, and a shot with 150 kids were putting through UCLA. Close your eyes, darling.
Oh. Fuzzy, darling, it's beautiful.
Not as beautiful as you, my puss.
Oh, I am the happiest woman in the entire world.
Who's adored by the happiest man in the world.
That is just the beginning.
Frankie, it's like I already told you. Smitty was sick, and Julie told me that he was a little nervous to go to the hospital by himself, so you went with him to Cedars.
Hold on, well, let's think about this, okay? Maybe she just assumed that I went with him to Cedars.
No, I mean, Frank, all right, even if she assumed, or even if I jumped to a conclusion, and still, what about what she said to you? She told you that I was in the park, and she knew that I went to Cedars. I told her. I mean, what do you think about that?
I don't know.
Well, I do know, Frank. I think that she was trying to separate us that night so that she could be alone with you.
I hate to think that.
Well, it's the only thing I can think of. Please, Frank, you and I both know Julie. I mean, she's lied to us before. I mean, what about the time that she said that I made her fix the bed 3 times? Yeah, and then I confronted her, and she said that it was because she envied me. She said a lot of things, but she did not tell me the absolute truth, which is that she has a big crush on my husband.
Look, I hear and I know what you're saying, and I agree with you.
So you agree that she has a crush on you? Yes, you agree. Okay, look, Frank, at first I thought it was a very innocent little crush, okay? I mean, why not? I mean, you're very handsome, and you're a wonderful man. I mean, what girl would not want to have a crush on you? No, it's true. But then this fiesta thing happened, and it's not innocent anymore, Frank. And that attack happened to her, and we both felt so badly. But still, Frank, I think that Julie is seriously trying to come between us.
Good morning, Nadine.
Hello, Paulie.
Oh, you talked to me. That's a good... I got it.
Thank you. I was talking to you last night. Just a little distracted.
Oh, I saw that. I saw that. But it wasn't because of my proposal.
Paulie, I've got something personal that I have to ask you. I hope you don't think I'm rude. But that diamond ring that you showed me last night, that it's very expensive.
And you want to know where I got the wherewithal. First of all, Nadine, I got a new job with Mindy Lewis. You were there. You helped me get it.
And second of all?
Second of all, I'm embarrassed. Because I got that ring on credit, hoping to intend to pay the whole thing off, Nadine. Listen, if you accept that ring, which would make me the happiest man in the world, it would be yours completely, forever. You wouldn't ever have to worry about repossession or anything like that. I am a financially responsible person, Nadine. I just want you to know that right up front. Now, I hope that lays to rest any fears that you have on that score.
Well, thank you for explaining that to me, Paulie.
It's my pleasure. But like you, I have a concern regarding your feelings towards Buzz and whether or not you're going to be able to see yourself clear in the future to have another relationship. Namely, with me.
Hi, Nadine.
I'm starving. Congratulations, you two.
Thanks. Everything's on the house today.
Oh, great. Thank you.
Nick, I really don't understand. Why do you want to live in that house of all places?
The short answer? Because it's my house, and you're my wife, and why shouldn't we live in a big, beautiful home that we can call our own?
Great. We'll live in a big, beautiful house that we build ourselves, like we talked about.
All right. Okay, look, let me try and explain this to you so you'll understand how important this is to me, okay? Melinda, when we first moved into Alexandra's house after the fire at the lighthouse, it was like a revelation to me. It was the last thing in the world that I expected, but there I was with these feelings that I was living close to my own history. My grandfather lived in that house with my mother and my uncle.
So what, you want to live there out of a sense of history?
No, not just that. You know, maybe it started out that way, okay? But it's a completely different story now. Melinda, you and I would be married for almost 2 years by now if certain people, namely my mother, hadn't interfered with our lives. Now, I need to go to that house today with you there by my side so that we can show Alexandra that this is the way it's going to be, that you're my wife and I love you, and she has to get used to that.
No, honey, I agree. Moving away can be a quick fix for what ails you. Starting over is scary, but it's always good.
But it's just that you're going to have too much of a good thing. I mean, I have started over so many times, I feel like I'm doomed to repeat it till I get it right.
When I came here, it was something I dreaded, but it was something I wanted, and I think I pulled it off. Well, at least I'm on the right track. But I think that if I moved away, it wouldn't feel like starting over. It'd feel like a step backward.
You never tried it with me. I would make certain that you didn't feel that way.
If anybody could, you could. No, I got unfinished business here, you know? No. I have a vision, too. My four grandsons.
Dad? This is Frank Achilles Cooper III. We're going to name him Achilles. And this, Dad, this is Little Buzz. After you.
Little Buzz. What do you know? Wanted him to kiss my ring. Where are the other ones?
This. Is little Harley named after his aunt, and this is little Pops named after your father, Pops.
Pops will be bursting with pride. Four fine boys. My blessing on all of them. And this for their college tuition.
Oh, Buzz.
For the boys and for the feminine child.
Melina.
So they don't have to worry about their future.
You are the best dad a son could ever have.
And the best ex-husband too, Buzz.
Sister Mike, now married to God. So how are things at the convent?
Peaceful, Buzz. We pray for you every day.
This week's contribution.
You're an angel. Bless you. Buzz! I need your help.
Alexander.
So what do you want, Alexander?
Somehow I have managed to alienate everyone close to me. But everyone loves you, your family. They respect you. The whole town loves you. What is your secret?
Oh, I can tell you what his secret is. He's a very loving, caring, generous sort of man. His neighbors and family adore him and love him. And I, for one, will love him till the day I die. Are you telling me... Is what you're really saying that you don't want to ever leave Springfield?
So you think he's justified in going behind my back?
I am saying that the man cares. What, are you really willing to become estranged from your son for the rest of your life? Are you willing to push it that far just to prove that you're right? You see, this is what drives me nuts about you. It scares me. Whenever you find yourself in one of these righteous binds, you see enemies everywhere.
I know you're not my enemy.
Of course not, and I hope you never forget that. But I don't think you realize exactly how high the stakes are here for me and my son. That's why it took me so long to make up my mind to move into this dump. Look, my son Ben needs a real home, someplace that is safe and secure, not the eye of a hurricane. And frankly, I'm beginning to have second thoughts about this moon. Part of me just wants to pack up our junk and move right back down the hill to our place.
Oh, please don't leave.
Then why not?
Because I need you. And not just as some backdrop. I need you in a very basic, essential way. Even that marvelous son of yours keep me grounded in reality. Honestly, I think I'd go nuts if you weren't here. Come on, just help me. Help me get myself out of this bind and put myself in. Mm-hmm.
Now you're talking.
I watched you plan that party for Fletcher and Alexandria after the vacation. You were in your element, Melinda, around all those big, beautiful old things. And I love seeing you like that. And I remember thinking that you could be happy in a place like that, okay? That's the impression that you gave me. Mm. If the circumstances were all right.
Well, that's the point. The circumstances weren't right. The house is not the problem. Nick, the circumstances are never going to be right.
All right. Okay. Look, all right, fine. We'll find someplace else. It'll be all right.
Okay. Okay, we'll give it a try.
Are you sure?
No. I have very big doubts that your mother's ever going to accept me, no matter what we say or do, but I'm beginning to understand how much it means to you. And I would never stop you from doing something so important.
Melinda, my mother owes us for the time that we lost. The house is just a down payment.
All right. I'm game if you are.
I love you so much, Melinda Sue Lewis.
Spalding.
That's right.
Yeah, well, I guess I'll get used to it.
You know, when I asked Julie where you were, she said that she didn't hear everything she said because it was too noisy.
Yes, it was noisy, Frank, but believe me, she heard me.
Yeah, but then she also said that you headed in the direction of the park. I mean, that's the only reason why I went looking for you there.
Well, I guess you could say I headed in the direction of the park, since the park surrounds the entire fiesta. I mean, where does this leave us, Frank?
Leaves us with not much proof at all.
Oh.
You know, I would really hate to confront her without knowing for sure.
Yeah, you're right. But even if we do not have proof, Frank, believe me, I know that Julie wanted us separate that night for her own reasons.
No, I know what you're saying. I really know, but Eleni, after that vicious attack that she had, I mean, I can't imagine that she would go after me or anybody else. I mean, I would think that'd be the last thing in her mind. But I want you to know something. If it isn't, you gotta trust me on this. I can handle it, okay?
Hello, Frank. I'm just glad we got a chance to talk about this and get it all out in the open.
Me too. Love you.
Love you too. Oh, I better go to that appointment. You have one more?
Okay.
Well, now you have the whole house to yourself.
Oh, right.
Is everything else okay, honey?
Yeah. Everything's fine. Everything's gonna be okay.
Good.
I love you.
Oh, I love you too. Bye, handsome.
Have a good day.
Goodbye.
First thing you're going to have to do is put yourself in Nick's shoes. Imagine Nick, he's standing there. And he sees his cousin and partner, Alan Michael, seething because Alan Michael cannot hand over WSPR to Julie Grant as he has promised because you say he can't do it. So what do? First thing you do is turn around and hand over WSPR to Nick, knowing full well how that is going to aggravate his fiancée, Mindy. So what does Nick do? He placates Mindy, and by making an offer to his cousin, Alan Michael, by...
Double-crossing me. Now, is that one of those things I brought on myself?
What I'm saying is that there's a better way to solve the situation than setting those two cousins against one another.
Oh, please, I have a right to give
Are you going to stand here and listen to my opinion, which you have solicited, or am I going to stand here and listen to you whine excuses?
Go on.
All right. Thank you. Second issue. Moving out without telling you, which is closely tied to getting married without telling you. Now, do you find it so strange
that Mindy would want to have her own place out from underneath your disapproving eye, and that the two of them would want to have a wedding with no surprises.
All right. All right. Why don't you try putting on my shoes for a moment?
I have done that so many times. My feet are scrunched up.
All right, we'll try a different pair of shoes. The shoes I was wearing when I discovered I had a second son. Who was alive? I had stopped thinking of myself as a mother, you know? Probably because it hurt too much. But then when we discovered Nick was alive, and proven beyond a shadow of a doubt that he was mine, those feelings started to spring up again. And it wasn't easy for me. I had to learn to allow myself to love and trust him.
I know how hard that was for you. But you did learn to love again, and I'm sure that hasn't changed.
Well, I guess it probably hasn't, has it? Otherwise, why would I feel so incredibly hurt? But you know, there's still one thing that you haven't proven to me, and neither is Nick, that he has any love or respect for me at all.
I know that he wants to, but you certainly haven't made it easy for him, even allowing for all those grand gestures you've made on his behalf.
Well, I'm probably not the easiest person for someone to love, now am I, Fletcher? You, above all people, should know that. But I do hope I'm worth the effort.
You are. Of course you are. But you have asked me to help you. And I can't very well help you unless you're willing to compromise.
Fine, but he's going to have to come to me and apologize.
He tried that last night, and that wasn't acceptable.
Okay. As you say, today is a new day. And if he's sensitive at all to any of my feelings, I think he'll come here and without Mindy. I hope so.
Even when Buzz and I were married, he really wasn't mine. And personally, I don't think he's going to be jealous either, but maybe that isn't any of my business.
I suppose not.
Yeah, well, the problem is he made it my business. He made it all of our business when he came back after 20 years and plopped himself smack dab in the middle of our family and demanded that we take notice. Not that we wanted to. We really didn't want to. I mean, I didn't, and the kids didn't. But Buzz just twisted himself into a pretzel and demanded that we notice him. And he worked so hard until he convinced us that what he really wanted most in the whole world was to be in our family again. And so we took him back, all of us. It took a little longer with Frank, but he finally came around. And then Lucy showed up, and we accepted her, too. Even though it was the first time that I had heard that there was any kind of marriage after hours. But then, you know, after that, everything was fine. Everything settled down. Things were good, Polly. They were really good. Until Jenna. But Buzz wanted her. And he got her. And then he wanted us to accept her. And it was rocky at first. It was really hard. But, you know, we even managed to pull that off. I mean, everybody is entitled to seek their own fulfillment, right?
Right.
Now, I know that sounds like a thing, but I just made that up.
No, it's good. It's good.
It is good. But now, all of a sudden, he wants out. He wants out of the diner. He wants out of Fifth Street. He wants to give up everything that he worked so hard to get back again. I don't know. I just don't get it. All right, maybe I sound like sour grapes, like I'm begrudging him his upward mobility or something, but that is not it, Polly. That is really not it, honestly. It's just the first time after he left, he lost himself. And it's taken him all this time to get himself back together again, and now I see it happening all over. And it just makes me very sad, that's all. I'm sorry. Here you are proposing marriage to me, and all I can do is talk about my ex-husband.
It's funny in a way, Nadine. Listening to you talk about Buzz gives me some hope. Because if you still love him, and he's given you so little. Nadine, I would give you so much more than Buzz ever did. But I'm not going to pressure you. I just ask one thing. Think about it. Think about it.
Buzz, if all you wanted was to be the king of Fifth Street, then you would have remarried Nadine and settled into middle-aged complacency. But you didn't choose to do that, my love. You chose to have a life with me.
Yeah. But we can be happy right here.
There are so many bad memories here. Everywhere I turn, something's hitting me in the face. We go out to dinner at a restaurant, and you can be certain that Roger Thorpe is going to be sitting at the very next table. Oh. Every time I walk by Cedars Hospital, I relive everything that went on there. And I'm always thought of as the ex-jewel thief, the one who stole Spaulding and then just lost it. And you, you're thought of as the man who deserted his family and came back to make amends. Why do we have to go through this all the time? Why can't we move somewhere else and just be us?
But honey, you're forgetting that where we're here, we're going to be making happy memories. So that after a while, you're going to look around, there's just not going to be all the sad ones.
What's wrong with wanting just happy ones?
You know, there is a practical side to this, too. I mean, we have $100,000. It doesn't buy that much anymore, if you're not careful. Oh, my God.
What?
I just remember Pops. My dad, that's what people called him. He told me something. It must have been 1,000 times. And I always thought he was nuts, but I think I just got it this moment.
What? What did Pop say?
One day I was about like 6 or 7 years old, and I came through the door, came back from school, and he was there, and he had a crisp $100 bill. He told me to sit on his lap, and he gave me the $100 bill and said, what would I do with it if it was mine?
And what did you say you would do?
I said, well, I was 7 years old. I said, I'll buy a horse, I'll buy a house, I'll get that taxi to take me to and from school. Practical things like that. Yeah. But I said to him, well, it's not my $100, it's your $100. What are you going to do with it? And this before he had a dime. All he did was have a push cart. And he said, well, I'm going to buy another push cart. And then he's going to save up for a few years and maybe he can buy 4 or 5 push carts. And then if he gets enough money and that works out, he'd be able to buy a place with walls and places for people to sit.
I bet he was very proud of owning the diner.
Yes, he was. We have $140,000. I could buy a lot of push carts or a lot of bottles of body lotion to make and sell. Anything. And then, after a while, if you still want to, we can go to Beverly Hills or wherever the hell you want to go to. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes. Yes, I understand. This place and your family, they mean a great deal to you.
No.
More than I mean to you, I think.
I didn't mean that.
You didn't mean that. You probably didn't mean that. Maybe there are a lot of things that you don't mean, but you say them. Nadine did mention that. But do you know one of the big differences between she and I is that she can accept that and live with it. I can't. I love you. And I want your word to mean something. And I'm afraid the more I get to know you, the more I'm afraid this isn't going to work out.
How you doing? You doing all right?
A few butterflies, but I'll be okay.
You just stick with me, all right?
I guess this means we're not going on a honeymoon anytime soon, are we?
Sweetheart, I promise you, you do this for me, and I will take you on the longest, bestest honeymoon you've ever dreamed of. Anywhere you want in the whole galaxy, okay?
You better.
Come on.
All right. Maybe no one's here. We got a reprieve. Might be lucky. Oh, you know what I need? Oh, a nice hot bubble bath. Can't wait to get out of this dress. I feel like I've been in it for 5 days.
I can't wait to take you out of this dress.
Mm.
And I guess you probably need someone to scrub your back while you're in the tub.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. Well, it would really help if that someone was in the tub with me.
Oh, I'm sure that can be arranged. Well, in that case, it's probably best that Alexandra's not here right now.
Yeah. You know, I just realized we don't have any clothes here.
Don't worry about it. Look, we'll get everything sensible, okay?
Oh.
And then once we get settled in, we'll let everybody know where we are.
All right.
People like me?
This is another one of your surprises.
Alexandra, I'm glad that you're here.
Are you really? It sounded to me like you'd both be happier if I dropped off the face of the earth.
No, actually, I came here to see you.
Oh, don't lie to me. I just heard you now.
Lagoon, Alexandra.
Oh, no. I told you what my bottom line was, and this is way below it. No, he doesn't give a damn about me, and this proves it. I want you both out of here. I don't want you under my roof.
Your roof? I think you're forgetting something, Alexandra. This is my house now.
Listen to him, Fletcher. His house? This house will never be yours if you live here 100 years. You don't belong here. You don't measure up.
Oh, no, Nick, see, I have a legal document that says that I do belong.
Oh, once again, my generosity is being used against me. I can't believe I could be so wrong about anyone.
You know something? One of the reasons why I came back here was to try and make peace with you.
I don't know what I was thinking. I should have known better.
Oh, you should have known better. Yes, you may have the legal documents to this house, but it's my house. Everybody knows it. It always will be, no matter how many people try to steal it from me.
You know, there you go again, Alexandra. Changing your mind, holding on to something you've already given away. You've done it so many times with Alan Michael, I don't know why I thought I would escape the treatment.
What, are you playing the poor victim here now? You're the one who moved out, my dear. Excuse me. Snuck out in the middle of the night. No, actually, you had your slut bride here.
Hey!
But for you. What? Are you going to hit me, dear?
No, I'm not going to hit you, Alexandra. But don't you ever call my wife anything like that again. Do you understand?
Perfectly. You're two of a kind. You two deserve each other. Now get out of my house. I can't believe you tried to sneak back in again.
Nobody was trying to sneak anywhere. You don't listen, do you? You know, you jump to conclusions, you think you have all the answers, but you don't. You can take my word for it.
I will never take your word for anything again as long as I live. I don't want anything to do with you.
That's fine. That's fine, Alexandra. I've done fine without you most of my life. I'll do fine now. But as far as Melinda and I are concerned, we're not going anywhere. So if you don't like this arrangement, you can get out of the house yourself.
You don't think it's going to work? Is that
what
you're
saying? See how it can. We're such completely different people.
We're not talking about different here. We're talking about right or wrong.
Oh, that's lovely coming from you. Do you know what I think your problem is?
What?
You are afraid of taking risks, Buzz. You are a big fish in a very small pond right now. But if you were to move to a new place, you'd be just a little fish.
I'm afraid of taking risks? Who's the... Am I not the guy who went out and got $140,000 on demand? Am I not the guy that came into court with a document that stripped you of Spalding Enterprises and I risked you hating me for the rest of my life?
Well, that could still happen. You are a bully, Buzz. You are sweet as candy when things are going your way, but when they're not, you're a bully. And you go on and on, claiming how much you love me, but when I ask just for one little thing that means something to me...
One thing?! One thing? You ask all the time. You are a regular asking machine. Why don't you ask yourself what makes me happy and do that, like,
what
once?
What do you think I was doing with that $10,000 that I gave to you so that you could feel the self-satisfaction of investing in our company? Yet you gave me, what, a tenth of it and then squandered the rest away?
Right. So you give me money to have the pleasure of seeing me give it back? Oh, yes, that's no ego. That's not manipulative. On top of that, you gave me Thorpe's money.
Oh, and it was a pittance for the pain that he caused me. Oh, I could have made a hell of a lot more money than that if I'd agreed to some stipulations, which right now I feel really stupid for not taking him up on.
What do you mean?
Roger offered me $100,000 instead of $10,000 if I agreed never to see you again. But I took the $10,000. Gee, how stupid can I get?
Well, maybe it's not too late. Maybe you should go back and see if we'll make the deal.
You are so full of yourself that you can't even show any gratitude?
Oh, thank you for not selling me for $90,000, which, as a matter of fact, that you would do every day when you're living on the hill with Raj.
You know what? You can live on Fifth Street for the rest of your damn life and rot.
Oh, good. Run away, Jenna. Story of your life. What happened? What are you doing here?
all this, Julie?
This has been Guiding Light. Jewelry provided by Irwin Pearl. Belts by Clara's Studio for Asymmetry.